Hi friends, welcome to Ground Improvement Techniques Module 4 class. Now next topic is ground anchors. We have already taken soil nailing in last class, so we have to continue that with ground anchors. So ground anchors could be employed to provide stability to natural grounds or structures built on such grounds. It is a method to provide stability to natural grounds or structures, and it is used because of the cost effectiveness compared to adopting rigid retaining wall or bracing system. And the use of this system requires careful evaluation of the durability of the structural elements used and assessment of the long-term system performance. Actually, there are two types of anchors. One is temporary anchors and permanent anchors. Temporary anchors, we can use it for not more than 3 years. But in the case of permanent anchors, it will function over the entire life of the structure they support. And these are the pictures of ground anchor. Okay, here there are two part, actually the free length and fixed length tendon and grout, which is used for anchoring. And in last picture it is shown some tendons used there. So it is also called tie backs. Then parts of the ground anchors are: first one, anchorage; second one, unbonded length; third one, bonded length. As you can see, anchorage part consists of an anchor head and a bearing plate, and unbonded length consists of tendon, a tromfet, etc. And bond length consists of grout, bonded tendon, etc. So here is some pictures of anchorages. So first picture shows the anchorage components of a bar tendon, and second picture shows the anchorage components of a strand tendon. The anchorage is the combined system of anchor head, bearing plate and trumpet that is capable of transmitting the pre-stressing force from the pre-stressing steel to the ground surface or the supporter structure. Okay. So, as a connecting system, we can use both bar and strand. So, when we use bar, first picture shows the connecting system when we use bar, and second picture shows the connecting system when we use strand. Second part is unbonded length or free stressing length. The unbonded length is that portion of the pre-stressing steel that is free to elongate elastically and transfer the resisting force from the bond length to structure. So it helps in the transfer of resisting force from the bond length to structure. In unbonded length, a bond breaker is also provided in the form of a plastic sleeve that prevent the pre-stressing steel from bonding to surrounding grout. So there is no contact between pre-stressing steel and surrounding ground in unbounded length. And it also enables the pre-existing steel in the unbounded length to elongate without obstruction during testing and stressing, and leaves the pre-existing steel unbounded after lock off. And then bonded length. So it is very important part of the anchor. The tendon bond length is that length of the pre-existing steel that is bonded to the grout and is capable of transmitting the applied tensile load into the grout. And it is the key part. It actually transfers the whole force to the ground. So as you know that the anchor bond length must be located behind the critical failure surface. But if it is located above the critical failure surface, there is no use. Okay, so this ground anchors have various applications, like it is provided to rehabilitate existing retaining walls. So if we can provide support to existing retaining walls through this ground anchors, it will be very effective, and it is also effective in resisting uplift in hydraulic structures, dams, weirs and spillways, and also to prevent flotation of underwater structures and provide reaction of piles. So if we once install the pile, and the pile cannot have much strength to support the supporting structure, we can provide these ground anchors to anchor the pile. And it also helps to stabilize the existing and potential landslides. So we must know that due to the lack of stability, there may be happening landslides. So by providing ground anchors, we can effectively anchor unstabilized rocks and ground, etc. And it is also helps to provide anchor suspension cables and weirs, and to prevent heave due to swelling soils. I think that you all know what is heave, and it also prevents heave. Okay, heave means once the moisture content of the soil is frozen, and there may be an increase in volume, so the surface will be expanding. But by providing anchors, we can resist frost heat, and also it helps to provide preloading of a foundation and in situ ground reinforcement. So here is the illustration of some of the applications. Okay, in dams, vertical anchors are provided below the foundations of concrete dam to prevent its overturning. So one of the essential causes of overturning of dams is maybe its hydrographic pressure from the left side. So to prevent or to permanently anchor the dam, we can provide permanent ground anchors below the foundation of dam, as you can see in the figure. Also, it also helps to anchor the concrete walls, concrete retaining, vertical concrete retaining wall. If the wall is constructed for a depth which is greater than specified depth, they may be subjected to overturning of the wall. But by providing anchors, we can effectively hold the concrete wall vertically. So by providing permanent anchors like this, we can permanently
anchor the vertical walls. So in tunnel portal, there may be chance of landsliding or the top portion of the tunnel. So to stabilize the top portion of the tunnel, we can provide permanent anchors, as you can see in the figure. Also in the case of towers, the foundation, if the foundation is not of much stability, we can provide permanent ground anchors at suitable intervals to stabilize the foundation of the tower. Vertical rock and soil anchors are also provided below the foundation of tall structures like chimney, transmission line tower, to prevent its overturning. The overturning may be because of the tensile force in the lines, in the power lines. So by anchoring suitable, by anchoring the foundation by suitable permanent ground anchor, we can stabilize that. Then there are four types of ground anchors in USA. First one is straight sharp gravity grouted ground anchors. It is also known as type A, and straight sharp pressure grouted ground anchors known as type B, and post grouted ground anchors, also under rimmed anchor. Then what you mean by under rimmed anchor? You also know that under rimmed pile. Okay, under rimmed pile mean at the end of the or at the portion of end bearing, there may be there is a bulging, there is a bulge like formations of at the, and it also provides it also helps in end bearing. It will increase the end bearing capacity of the pile. So similar to the pile, also in anchor there is under rim. Okay, the procedures and methods used to drill holes for ground anchors are usually selected by the contractor. Okay, the procedures and methods is decided by contractor. Okay, the choice of particular drilling method must also consider the overall site conditions. It means by considering the overall site condition, we can choose the particular type of ground anchors. So first one is straight shaft gravity grouted grout anchors. Okay, and it is typically installed in rock and very stiff to hard cohesive soils deposits using either rotary drilling or hollow stem auger methods. So for installing these types of anchors, we can use rotary drilling or hollow stem auger methods. Then tremie methods are used to grout the anchor in a straight shaft bore hole. In concrete technology, you have studied tremie pipe. That is, by gravity displacement, we deposit concrete to form a column-like structure. So tremie methods are used to anchor the grout, or used to provide the grout to anchor in this method. The borehole may be cased or uncased depending upon the stability of the borehole. Means, if the soil is not of much strength, we have to provide a casing. But if the soil is of much strength, we can provide uncased. We remain it as uncased, or depending upon the stability of the borehole. Also, the resistance to pull out the anchor depends upon the shear resistance between. It depends upon the shear resistance between the surface of the anchor and the surrounding soil. So here is the picture of a straight shaft gravity grouted anchor. You can see in this picture there is a bonded part and an unbonded part. Then straight shaft pressure grouted ground anchors. In these ground anchors, we are providing certain pressure. Okay, straight shaft pressure grouted ground anchors are more suitable for coarse granular soils and weak fissured rock. And it is more suitable for coarse granular soils and weak fissured rock. Okay, with this type of anchor, grout is injected into the bond zone under pressures greater than 0.35. Once we deposit grout in this type of anchor, we have to apply a pressure greater than 0.35 megapascal. Okay, for introducing borehole, we are using a hollow stem auger or using rotary techniques for this drill casings. Okay, as the auger casing is withdrawn, the grout is injected into the hole under pressure until the entire anchor bond length is grouted. Okay, so here is the picture of bonded length and unbonded length. As you can see, the bonded length is slightly larger than the unbonded portion because we are applying pressure. So using this pressure, grout will occupy more space than the previous anchor. So in this case, the grouting procedure increases the resistance to pull out related to trimming grouting methods. Because of, in this method, we are increasing the normal stress on the grout bulb resulting from compaction of the surrounding material locally around the grout bulb. When we are introducing pressure, the bonded length will increase its size, while increasing its size, it will exert some pressure to the surrounding soil and it will get compacted. Okay, so in this method, by increasing the effective diameter of the grout bulb, we can increase the resistance to pull out. So next type of anchors is to be discussed is post-grouted grout anchors. Okay, in post-grouted grout anchors, use delayed multiple grout injections to enlarge the grout body of straight shafted gravity grouted grout anchors, and each injection is separated by 1 or 2 days, which means once we are getting a borehole and then we are injecting grout. But in this case, only small amount of grout is injected first and it is allowed to set properly. And after setting that amount of grout, we are injecting again. After 1 day, we are injecting again some more amount of grout. Okay. Then using this method, then after injecting grout again, already set grout may fracture and extend to more space. Okay, then when we continue this procedure, we can get high strength grout around our tendon. Okay, then this post grouting is accomplished through a sealed grout tube installed with the tendon, and the tube is equipped with the check valves in the bond zone. The high pressure grout fractures the initial grout and wedges it outward into the soil, enlarging the grout body. The whole idea is to enlarge the grout body so that we can have higher strength. So it is the picture of the post grouted anchor. As you can see, already set grout fractures, and again it fractures and covers the tendon. It will occupy more space compared to previous anchor, and it will provide higher strength. And at last, under-rimmed anchors is not common, but it also can effectively use for providing higher strength. Under-rimmed anchors consist of trimmy grouted boreholes that include a series of enlargement bells or under-rims. As you can see in the figure, there are under-rims or bell-like structures which is provided in the bond zone around the tendon. And this type of anchor may be used in firm to hard cohesive deposits. Okay, in addition to resistance through side shear, as is the principle of load transfer mechanism for other anchors, resistance may also be mobilized through end bearing. So Usually, anchor provides strength to side shear, that is the shear strength between sides of the grout and the surrounding soil. But in this case, in addition to side shear, it will also provide strength through under rims. So these under rims will help to provide strength through end bear. So in the under rimmed anchors, it will provide strength through side shear also by end bear. Then components are there are certain components. First one is anchor head and tendon and anchor grout. Anchor head, it is a device usually consists of a plate and an anchor head with the wedges and connects the anchor to the supporter structure and permits the stressing and locking of the anchor. And I think there is no need of much explanation, as you can see in the figure. Tendon, and it is next component is tendon. It is made of pre-stressing steel wires, strands or bars, which transfers the anchor force to the grout. The tendon consists of anchor bond length and unbonded length. Okay, you also have seen that the picture of tendon in the previous slide. And then at last, anchor grout, it is also called primary grout. It's generally a Portland cement based mixture or a polymer resin and is used to transfer the anchor force to the grout. For use as the anchor grout, we use primary grout. Okay, which means a Portland cement based mixture is used as grout, or polymer resin is used as grout. Okay, then we will see anchor test. So by using this test, we can accept, after facing a certain criteria or to check whether the pile accepts or pile follows some certain criteria, we have to test these piles. We have to test these angles. So to test these angles and to check the performance of this anchor, we have to perform these three types of test. Okay, first one, performance test; second, proof test; and extended creep test. The third test, extended creep test, is performed after performed along the first two tests. So after doing performance test, we will do extended creep test, and after performing proof test also, we perform extended creep test. Okay, so a unique aspect of ground anchors as compared to other structural systems is that every ground anchor that is to be part of a complete structure is load tested to verify its load capacity and load deformation behavior before being put into service. Okay, and every ground anchor is tested using one of the particular tests introduced above, and then results of this test are compared to specified acceptance criteria to evaluate whether the ground anchor can be put into service. So after conducting this test, then we have to check the anchor must follow certain acceptance criteria, and if it follows the acceptance criteria, then we can use that anchor. Otherwise, we will have to replace or use the anchor to a certain purposes that have less load. The first one, performance test. Okay, performance test involved incremental loading and unloading of a production anchor. The performance test is used to verify, first one, anchor capacity; second one, establish load deformation behavior to identify forces of anchor movement and to verify that actual unbounded length is equal to or greater than assumed in the anchor design. So it is used to assess the performance of an anchor, and it is used to verify anchor capacity. Anchor capacity means it must be tested
It must be tested
whether it is capable to carry the intended load that we are assuming. Then to establish load deformation behavior. So the load deformation graph is important in all kinds of scenarios in civil engineering. So to establish a load deformation behavior, we have to conduct performance test. And to identify causes of anchor movement, we have to know the reason why this anchor is moved. So to assess the reason, to find out the reason behind the movement of anchor, we have to conduct performance test. And while we designing, an anchor, we have to provide a length for unbounded length. And to assess the length of unbounded length, we have to provide performance test, or we have to conduct performance test. So these are the step-by-step procedure for anchor test. Okay. So first step in a performance test comprises applying a nominal load to the anchor tender. Okay, we are applying a nominal load. A load is applied first. This load, termed the alignment load, is typically not more than 5% of the design load, and its purpose is to ensure that stressing and testing equipment are properly aligned. So once we apply a certain load to this anchor, and this applied load must be less than 5% of the design load. So we designed the anchor, so we know the design load. So first we have to apply a load which is less than 5% of the design load, and this is known as alignment load. And this applied to check the alignment of the anchor. Okay, then this alignment load is assumed as a datum, which means this alignment load is assumed as zero load. Okay, so after assuming it as zero load, we have to increase the load. Okay, so during the first load cycle, the load is raised to 25% of the design load, and the incremental movement is recorded. Okay, so during the first load cycle, after applying zero load, we have to increase 25% of the design load to first as a first step. Also, while increasing the load, the movement is also recorded. Okay, the next step, the load is then reduced back to the alignment load. After increasing a certain load, we have to decrease it back to the alignment load. Okay, this procedure is repeated until the maximum testing load, referred to as the test load, is achieved. Okay, this procedure is repeated. So first we have to increase the load to a certain limit, and then return back to the zero load, that means alignment load, and we again increase the load to another high percentage, that's greater than 25%, and then we decrease the alignment load, and then we increase the load to a 50% of the test load, and then again decrease back to alignment load. And this test load may vary from 120 to 150% of the design load, and this procedure is repeated until the load vary to 1.2 times to 1.5 times the design load. Okay, then a test load of 150% may be used for anchors in potentially creeping soils, or when an independent reference cannot be established for the dial gauge. It means, after increasing the load from zero load to a certain percentage, we have to hold that for certain time. Okay, which means from zero load, first step is to increase the load to a 25%, but after that you have to hold that load for certain time. It is for measuring certain movement that we'll describe in next slide. Okay, on the test load, a constant load is held for 10 minutes prior to reducing the load to lock off load. That means zero load. So during this 5-10 minute load hold period, movements are measured and recorded at 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 and 10 minutes. So after applying a certain amount of load, we have to hold that for 10 minutes. And each moment, each minute, we have to record the movement of anchor. The purpose of this load hold is to measure time dependent movements of the anchor. While we kept constantly load, we have to measure the movement. The movement may occur because of the creep. To assess the creep movement, we have to hold the each load for 10 minutes. And during this 10 minutes, we have to measure deformation for this particular load hold. Okay. And this portion of the performance test is referred to as a creep test. So this portion is referred to as creep test. Okay, this load hold, this time of load hold is defined as a creep test. So if the total movement between 1 and 10 minutes exceeds the specified maximum creep movement, so we have to set a limit for creep movement, and we know that, and during 1 to 10 minutes, if the movement of the anchor exceeds the creep movement, this test load is maintained for an additional 50 minutes. Okay, this test load is maintained for an additional 50 minutes and total movement is recorded at 20, 30, 40 and 50 and 60 minutes. Okay, so this movement exceeds 1 minute, this movement exceeds a limit, a specified limit. We have to do it for 60 minutes and we have to measure for every 20, 30, 40 and 50 and 60 minutes. Okay, so if the results of a creep test for a specified anchor indicate that creep movements are excessive relative to the specified criteria, that criteria will tell in next slide, the anchor must be incorporated into the structure at a reduced load. We must use that anchor for a reduced load. That's all. Then or anchor may be replaced. In another way is to replace the anchor totally. That is the only way. Next one is proof test. Okay. The proof test provides a means for evaluating the acceptability of anchors that are not performance tested. So all anchors in a ground, all anchors cannot be subjected to performance test. But so such anchor should be performed by strength checking of such anchor should be performed by proof test. Okay. The data from the proof test are used to assess the adequacy of the ground anchor, considering the same factors as for the performance test data. It's a miniature form of performance test. Okay, proof test is a miniature form of performance test, where proof test data show significant deviations from previous performance test data, an additional performance test is recommended on the next adjacent anchor. The data from proof test and performance test are different. If this, once we do a proof test on a certain anchor, and we will have the performance test data of another anchor from the same conditions, and if there is a difference in that, we have to do performance test data. Okay. In procedure, test one, same step, apply the alignment load at which the total movement is assumed equal to zero. First, you apply a alignment load as in the previous case. Then successively apply and record total movements for the following load increments to the test load. So first we have to increase 25% of the dead load, means design load, and then 50% and 75% and full percentage and 1.2% and 1.3 times of the test load. Then note that test load for an anchor for a temporary support for excavation application may be set at 1.2 dead load. If the anchor is used for a temporary application, the test load may be set at 1.2 times of the design load. Then hold test load for 10 minutes and record total movement. In this case, we have there is no necessity for recording at each minute. We have to we have to record the movement for a whole 10 minutes. Okay, then at last unload to alignment load and record residual movement. So once we apply a certain load and then measure displacement for 10 minutes and then we decrease back to the alignment load and note the residual movement. Okay, the test results satisfy acceptance criteria, reduce load to the lock of load. These acceptance criteria will tell after final slide. Okay, then if it will satisfy the acceptance criteria, reduce the load to the lock of load. Okay, then our anchor is sufficient. This means our anchor is sufficient. At last, extended creep test. This extended creep test are done after both performance test and proof test. Then an extended creep test is a long duration test, approximately 8 hours. It is a 8 hour duration test, and it is used to evaluate creep deformations of anchors. Okay, it is used to evaluate the creep deformations of anchor as at earlier. And these tests are required for anchors installed in cohesive soil having a plasticity index greater than 20 or liquid limit greater than 50, and it is done for a soil which is having plasticity index greater than 20 or liquid limit greater than 50. And then we have to move on to the procedures. The test arrangement for an extended creep test is similar to that used for performance or proof test. For obvious reasons, we can do the extended creep test after doing performance test or proof test. So the test arrangement will be similar. Then the increments of load for an extended creep test are the same as that of performance test. Okay, it is also obvious. At each load cycle, the load is held for a specific period of time and the movement is recorded. Okay, once we apply a certain load or once we increase from the zero load, we have to hold that for a specific period of time and movement needs to be recorded. So during this observation period, the load should be held constant. Then the load is assumed to be remain reasonably constant if the deviation from the test pressure does not exceed 0.35 MPa. Then how we know that our load is kept constant? So we have to measure the pressure. If the pressure does not deviate from 0.35 MPa for each loading, then we can say that our applied load is constant. Okay, the loading schedule and observation periods for each load cycle are provided in the table. So in this table, once we provide 0.25 design load, 0.25 times of design load, we increase the load from 0 to 0.25%, and we have to provide an observation period of 10 minutes, and for after each minute we have to record the movements of the anchor. Okay, then for 50, then we next step is when we increase 50%, we have to observe it for 30 minutes, and for 75%, we have to observe it for 30 minutes same, and we have to measure the movement for each measure the movements for first 1 minute, then after 2 minute, 3, 4, 5, 6. After 6, we can measure it after 10 minutes. Okay, after 10, we have to measure it for 15 minutes and 20 minutes, 25 minutes and 30 minutes, etc. etc. Okay. So these are the acceptance criteria that I have set earlier. So for performance and proof test, the measured total movement for the required load hold and the test load should not exceed 1 millimeter between 1 and 10 minutes. So during 1 and 10 minutes, for 10 minutes, the deformation of anchor should not exceed 1 millimeter. That is the criteria, test criteria. But if the movements are less than 1 millimeter for this period, the anchor is considered acceptable. Which means in performance test and creep test, the movements of the anchor pipe should not exceed 1 millimeter. If it should not exceed 1 millimeter, then we can use that pipe, sorry, we can use that anchor effectively. But if the total movement exceeds the criteria described above, that is, if it exceeds 1 millimeter, the load is held for an additional 50 minute period of time. If the deformation exceeds 1 millimeter, then we have to provide additional 50 minute period of time. If the measured total movement over this additional time period does not exceed 2 millimeter between 60 and 60 minutes, then have to provide another means another time. We have to provide some time more. Then we check that during 6 and 60 minutes, our displacement of the anchor must not exceed 2 millimeter. Otherwise, if the deformation is exceeded 2 millimeter, we have to change the anchor to another purpose. We have to replace the anchor. Okay, so if the measured total movement or this additional time period does not exceed 2 millimeter between 6 and 60 minutes, then the anchor is considered acceptable with respect to grip. Then we can use that anchor effectively if the deformation is less than 2 millimeter. Okay, thank you.